Hello and welcome back. It is Wednesday. My name is Gavin Fish. This is my channel. Thank you very much for being here. If you are brand new to my channel, then I invite you to head over to my website and see the kind of person that I am. I think it's a pretty good indication. I love case documents. This is the Jahlia Davis case, and these are the documents that I have gathered on her case. All of the cases on my website are extremely well documented, and it's because I love that sort of thing. I love digging into documents, crime scene photos, evidence, that sort of thing. So today, we are in that spirit, we're going to dig into a couple of documents in the case against Richard M. Allen, the case that's building against Richard M. Allen in the deaths of Abby and Libby in Delphi, Indiana. Now, I am not going to get into the particulars of the case. I'm not going to rehash, I guess, the case, because we all know what happened to Abby and Libby, and I know that new information is coming out all the time. But what I am going to do is I'm going to get into the particulars of the documents in the case against Richard M. Allen. So stick with me and we will dig right in. Before we really start diving in to Richard M. Allen's, the case against Richard M. Allen, I want to address a couple of comments that have come in, and I think now is as good a time as any. Aaron Bell 4903, in regards to the second video I did on the Shanquellen Robinson case, says the purpose of the repetitive discussion is to keep the conversation going. He's talking, what I said in the video is that there's just too much content that's being created as demand for more and more is I guess growing, then content creators are trying to meet that demand with a supply of just rehashing the same thing over and over again. So he's responding to that. The purpose of repetitive discussion is to keep the conversation going. It undertakes the principles of nonviolent disobedience. While many are unaware of what they are doing and simply are posting videos on what's the topic of public discussion, many others are aware and displaying the power of collective civic protest for justice through using their platforms. Take a look at the book, The Logic of Black Urban Rebellion, to obtain a philosophical, contextualized understanding of the necessary ongoing discussion to get justice for Shanquella and her family. And Aaron, I have purchased that book for my Kindle. I haven't started reading yet, but I appreciate you giving me that suggestion. And you are right that we do need to keep the Shanquella Robinson case within the public consciousness. And in fact, her family's asked for that. I find it extremely frustrating that I keep reading the same thing over and over and over and over again. Having said that, though, I think you make a valid point that there are a lot of people that may not even know about the case yet, and their first interaction with the case might be an article or a video that was made that is just saying the same stuff that's already been made. So you make a valid point. I think I need to repent of what I was complaining about, partly, I guess. But thank you for that comment. I appreciate it. Comment number two comes from Fane Brown, 8681, again about the Shanquella Robinson case. She says, I find it fascinating that Americans don't immediately know what femicide is. I watched Stephanie Harlow's video and this one, and a bit of time of each was spent explaining femicide. Here in Argentina, it is a commonly used term and an epidemic, but it just occurred to me that maybe it's because Latin American countries are more likely to view a woman as lesser, weaker, and more vulnerable because of historically and still held religious beliefs. America is very secular, even though it does have Christian roots. Yeah, and Fane, you and I actually had a pretty long conversation in the comments section about that. I actually lived in Argentina when I was a young man. That was where I served a mission for my church when I was young. And I love Argentina, and I understand exactly what you're saying. Yes, here in the United States, femicide, to my knowledge, is not a crime that is numerated, right? That is written down into law. It doesn't seem like we have that same epidemic of committing terrible crimes against women just because they are women. I mean, we do commit terrible crimes as a society against other groups of people in the United States because they belong to those other groups. But femicide is not something that most people here in the United States is familiar with. I actually had to look it up to see what femicide, what the definition was. And in Mexico, a lot of this had to do with drug cartels that were horribly, horribly abusing women as a punishment for other family members that had gone against the cartel. It's really, really quite ugly. So I think in this case, the silver lining to a very, very dark cloud is that the person or people responsible for Shanquella Robinson's death have a potentially more severe sentence in front of them if they're convicted. So it's not a good thing, but it is a silver lining. Thank you for that comment. I appreciate that. GFoxy713 disagrees with me. She says this video was pointless and basically clickbait. You most definitely are trying to capitalize off of this story, just like the rest of them. You offered no facts, just opinions and recycled information. There should be a limit to what you are all allowed to do. Y'all aren't thinking about her family, because if you were, all these pointless videos wouldn't be posted. So GFoxy713, I appreciate what you're telling me. I understand what you're telling me. I just disagree with how you characterize what I am doing. I make no secret of the fact that I would love to be doing YouTube full time. I would love that. But I'm not doing it to capitalize on horrific crimes. That's just not me. And exhibit to that would be go to my website and see the kinds of things that I am doing. However, your point is taken. I think that you make a valid point. Sorry that you grouped me in with the other content creators that I see as being guilty of what you're saying. But I will take your critique and try to improve how I make the content that I make and so forth. So thank you very much for that comment. The next comment comes from user BH8 blah, 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 in regards to the first video I did on the murder of Ellen Greenberg. This is ridiculous. Suicide, just the scalp alone, would cause excruciating pain. As a nurse of 22 years, I would bet my license on homicide. You share the same opinion that many of us do. The Ellen Greenberg case is infuriating that way. It just makes no sense. So if you are new to my channel and you don't know about the Ellen Greenberg case, just go to the playlist. It's an infuriating case. Last comment that I have for today is from Walker D 1114. Who says in regards to the murder of Ellen Greenberg part 5, you should test the door latch like it is in the picture at the scene with the two screws out, and then try to latch it from the outside to see if he did it prior to leaving. So I understand what you're saying, and I've gotten a lot of comments like that. What I was trying to do when I did my reenactment of breaking a door in that has that hotel style lock on it was to see if what was reported that Sam Goldberg said happened could have happened. It wasn't to prove any other theories of what might have happened. I just wanted to prove or disprove what Mr. Goldberg said. Well, what investigators said Goldberg said happened. So that's why I did that. Now, having said that, I would love to do all of the other reenactments and so forth of this. The problem is that I ruined a 120-year-old door casing when I did that video, and I don't want to ruin any more. And because I don't make a lot of money here on YouTube, I just don't have the budget to be going to buy doors and jams and casings to keep testing it. But thank you very much for that comment. I would hope that investigators would have done something like that, but it doesn't appear that they have. All right, guys. Thank you very much for those comments. If any of you would like me to read your, well, first of all, I read all of my comments. I respond to many of my comments, and I will put them in videos if they are, if they're a good critique of mine, if they make me think, if they, you know, if they're smart, I definitely will put those comments in my videos from time to time. Okay, the first thing that I want to do, digging into the case against Richard M. Allen, we have a couple of documents in this case, and the very first one that I think most of us already know about is the Affidavit of Probable Cause. Most of the videos that I've seen about this Affidavit of Probable Cause have just kind of done a cursory, here is what's inside this affidavit. But what I wanted to do first off was start talking about what is an Affidavit of Probable Cause. That seems to be a question that a lot of people have in the comments of some of the videos and articles, videos that I'm watching and articles that I'm reading. And so what I've done is in my day job, you guys may not know this if you are new to my channel, but in my day job, I work as a reporter for a publication out here in Western Pennsylvania. One of the things that we do on a daily basis is reach out to the district the magisterial district judges and request criminal complaints, and those criminal complaints always include an affidavit of probable cause, and then we report on those things. So we literally daily, a couple times a day, we reach out to these judges' offices and say, hey, have there been any new criminal complaints since the last time we talked at 6 o'clock this morning? And they'll say, yeah, we do have some here. We'll send them off to you. And some offices will fax them to you. Some will email them to you. Some will make you drive there, pick them up, pay for copies. But I guess the connecting theme here is that they are all public records. So I grabbed a couple of examples of recent affidavits that I want to show you guys. I think I should probably share my screen before I really dig into this. Okay, so this is in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. I have blocked out, all this redaction was done by me. It wasn't done by the court. I did that because I, on my platform, I didn't think it was really appropriate to really call somebody out. But this is an affidavit against a female who, it looks to me, we scroll down here, we've got a misdemeanor, one count against her, and the crime is endangering the welfare of children. And then number two is another misdemeanor, and it is prohibited acts. It's a health and safety thing. It's for use of drugs. And then the next page is always, I ask that a warrant of arrest or summons be issued, blah, blah, blah. And then the last page is usually, or the last few pages contain the affidavit of probable cause. Now, the affidavit has to prove to the satisfaction of a judge that this investigator or officer has probable cause to make an arrest or issue a summons. Or in some cases of affidavits, it's to issue a search warrant, right? So what they have to do is they have to articulate why they have their suspicions that would give them probable cause to do the action that they want to do. And the best way that I thought of to maybe give you an example of what is, what does work and what does not work is this. Say Kimberly and I, we put up a bar in our backyard. We don't get licensing for it, and we have a fence around it. It's kind of a speakeasy kind of thing. The neighbors know about it, and they can come and walk into our backyard, and they can buy booze from this bar. They can have a good time and then walk home. That is an illegal establishment where I live. I could not do that. I would not do that also, but, so say a police officer gets wind of this and goes, okay, we're going to arrest Gavin, or we're going to give him a writ of summons. And they write an affidavit that says, "Dear Judge, I heard from my friend that Gavin Fish in his backyard has this bar where he's charging people money to come and drink. He doesn't have licensing. I understand there's no licensing involved either. And so I would like to arrest Gavin for the crime of whatever that crime would be," right? Okay, that does not work. That is not an affidavit of probable cause, because that officer would be telling the judge what he heard or what he thinks, not what he knows. What that affidavit would have to contain is something like this. The officer would say, "On December 7th, 2022, I became aware of an illegal speakeasy in the backyard of Gavin Fish. I went to the backyard, I entered where I witnessed whoever, you know, purchasing liquor from Gavin Fish across his bar and drinking it on premises. I looked around, I could not see any licensure displayed. I asked Gavin for a license and he just laughed and said, 'I don't have a license.'" So that is how it would have to be. It'd have to be firsthand knowledge. And so when we look at affidavits of probable cause, you can see that they're written that way. Okay, Chief Winter and myself responded to yada yada for the report of a medical call, 37-year-old female at this address. Upon arrival, we made contact with the person who resides at the address. She stated, and I saw, and blah, 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 right? So it is a very detailed and sometimes well-written, not all the time, but sometimes well-written description of everything that they know, that they witness themselves, that they have the evidence of themselves. Another example of this is, this is a felony charge against a man here in Western PA. "Judge Andrew Fish is no relation to me that I know." But when we get down to the accusation, it looks like it's a felony one. It's a kidnapping charge. And there might be another charge here. Yeah, another felony one, aggravated assault. So two felony counts. And then, you know, asking, this is the request. I'm asking to, you know, make this arrest. And then here's the affidavit of probable cause. And it goes through, you know, on July 14th, 2022 at 09:49 hours. By the way, sometimes like these affidavits will be many months old, right? Like, this happened, what this officer is saying happened in July. And I think they filed this in November. So it goes through a long description of what he believed or what he knows, what he witnessed and who he interviewed and so on and so forth. So that is what an affidavit of probable cause looks like. Those are two examples of those. You guys can, in your area, get access to these. These are public records. So if you're curious and if you want to start investigating crimes, a good way to start is to call the local judge, the local court in your area. It'll be dependent on your area where you call the court, but basically the lowest court in your area, you call them and say, "Do you have any criminal complaints?" And they're required by law in most areas to give that to you. So, so let's go over to the affidavit of probable cause against Richard Allen. There are a couple things in here. Basically, what they do in this affidavit is they state their entire case about Abby and Libby being on the bridge, and they put Richard M. Allen on the bridge through witnesses and then through talking with Richard Allen himself. The two things, though, that I think are the most important probably have to do with a couple of pieces of evidence. The first is the car, right? That witnesses saw a purple PT Cruiser or small SUV type vehicle parked at a certain location. And then in another place in the affidavit, where did that go? Let me see. Another place in the affidavit. Here we go. Investigators note witnesses described the vehicle parked at the former CPS building as a PT Cruiser, small SUV, or smart car. Investigators believe those descriptions are similar in nature to a 2016 Ford Focus. So that is one piece of physical evidence that they brought up in the affidavit that I want to go over, because I'm not going to read this entire affidavit in this video, but there is another document that I want to read in its entirety. But let me just kind of look for this. Okay. This is a, investigators believe Richard Allen was not seen on the trail after 2:13 PM because he was in the woods with victim one and two, an unspent 40 caliber round between the bodies of victim one and two was forensically determined to have been cycled through Richard Allen's Sig Sauer model P226. Okay, so I wanted to talk about that a little bit. And I thought about grabbing one of my firearms to show you this, but I feel like if I did that, I don't think YouTube would take kindly to that. So I'm not going to do that. I have it sitting on the desk next to me, but I'm not going to do that. Instead, let me just say that basically what they're saying is that there was an unspent round. That means a bullet that was not fired, but was cycled through a semi-automatic gun. Okay. Because it was cycled through that gun, there were scratch marks on the casing of the bullet that they at the lab compared against another round after getting his 6 hour P226 and cycling around through it. They then compared the two and said, yeah, these match. And if we go into, let me see if I can find this here real quick. Yeah, here we go. So I want to read this paragraph right here for you guys, okay? So this is the lab's remarks about them, comparing the unspent rounds. An identification opinion is reached when the evidence exhibits an agreement of class characteristics and a sufficient agreement of individual marks. Sufficient agreement is related to the significant duplication of random, striated, impressed marks as evidenced by the correspondence of a pattern or combination of patterns of surface contours. The interpretation and identification is subjective in nature and based on relevant scientific research and the reporting examiner's training and experience. So they're saying, yeah, this is subjective in nature. It's our opinion that the bullet that was found on the ground near Libby and Abby was cycled through Richard M. Allen's P226. And if I could just describe this without kind of showing you, in a semi-automatic weapon, there are a series of metal pieces that look to have been stamped out from sheet metal. And then there are several processes to bend them and to sharpen them in some cases, put a bevel on them. They almost look polished, like they've been through a tumbler. I don't know if you guys know this, but I was in manufacturing of high-end audio gear for a lot of years. So understanding the different processes involved in manufacturing, that's what it looks like to me. So what they're saying is that, Sig Sauer, if they made a million of these handguns, they would all be slightly different, even though they went through the same processes of manufacture. And on a microscopic level, I don't think that I would disagree with that. There would be differences, but are there enough differences to be able to definitively say, you know, this bullet was cycled? If you had like 4 6-hour P226s in front of you, could you say it was cycled through this one, not these other three? And I think the defense is going to probably bring that up. In fact, I know they are because I've read their press release. So let's take a look at their press release. And this is a document that I do want to read in its entirety. And if you guys, by the way, if you want me, I have not made a Delphi murders case page on my website because there hasn't been anything that I could put up there in the past. But now that we have these, maybe I will. Let me know in the comments down below if you want me to do that. But let's read this. Okay, as Richard Rick Allen's attorneys, we have received multiple requests from local and national media for interviews and comment since the unsealing of the probable cause affidavit. It would be virtually impossible to comply with these requests and continue to focus on the merits of Rick's defense. Therefore, we offer up these thoughts. We do not want to try this case in the media, and we intend to adhere to the Indiana Rules of Professional Conduct that provide guidance on pre-trial publicity. However, the police and prosecutor's office have conducted many press conferences over the 5+ years of this investigation and following our client's arrest. On the other hand, Rick's ability to assert his innocence has been reduced to only one short post-hearing press conference. Accordingly, we feel it appropriate, necessary, and within the bounds of our rules of professional conduct to make a few comments regarding the probable cause affidavit and Rick's innocence. Rick is a 50-year-old man who has never been arrested nor accused of any crime in his entire life. He is innocent and completely confused as to why he has been charged with these crimes. I found that sentence to be pretty telling. I have heard lawyers in the past say stuff like that first part. My client has never been charged or even suspected of a crime in his entire life. He is pure as the wind-driven snow. And then that's where they stop, because they don't want to go as far as to say my client is innocent. They don't want to actually lie, right? But in this case, they are saying that. Their client is innocent, completely confused as to why he has been charged with these crimes. I don't know. I mean, maybe they believe that he is innocent of the charges. And in America, as you guys all know, he is innocent until proven guilty beyond a reasonable doubt. So that is important. Next, the police did not contact Rick after Libby German and Abby Williams went missing. Rather, Rick contacted the police and voluntarily discussed being on the trail that day. Like many people in Delphi, Rick wanted to help any way he could. Rick contacted the police to let them know that he had walked on the trail that day, as he often did. Without Rick coming forward, the police probably would not have had any way of knowing that he was on the trail that day. Rick volunteered to meet with a conservation officer outside of the local grocery store to offer up details of his trip to the trail on the day in question. Rick tried to assist with the investigation and told the police that he did recall seeing three younger girls on the trail that day. His contact with the girls was brief and of little significance. Rick does not recall if this interaction with the conservation officer was tape recorded, but believes that the conservation officer scribbled notes on a notepad as Rick spoke to him. After Rick shared this information with law enforcement, he went back to his job at the local CVS and didn't hear from the police for more than 5 years. The next time Rick heard from the police was in October 2022. This was approximately 2 weeks before a contested sheriff's election, and I'm not sure why they bring this up. And within days of a federal lawsuit filed against the Carroll County Sheriff's Office by its former second-in-command, Michael Thomas. I think they're just trying to establish that the sheriff's office is in disarray, right? In the lawsuit, Thomas claims that he, Thomas, had made suggestions and offered assistance in the investigation of a high-profile child homicide investigation, but those suggestions and offers were rejected by the sheriff. Thomas further claimed that the sheriff and others in the department feared the disagreements with Thomas would become publicized as a result of the political campaign for sheriff. Thomas claims in the suit that he was ultimately demoted and replaced by Tony Liggett, who later that year won the 2022 election for sheriff. Furthermore, Thomas claims he was also removed from high-profile cases. Again, not sure why they brought this up. I have not looked up the federal lawsuit. I think maybe I should do that. That is something that is certainly findable through the PACER system. So I think I will do that. And maybe that's another document that I could share with you guys. Lawyers hardly ever just do something just for the sake of doing it. So there has to be something to that they think is important to their case, but they can't say more at this point, or they won't. Rick was ultimately arrested on or about October 28th, 2022. In the 5+ years since Rick volunteered to provide information to the police, Rick did not get rid of his vehicle or his guns and did not throw out his clothing. He did not alter his appearance. He did not relocate himself to another community. He did what any innocent man would do and continued with his normal routine. Yeah, I mean, innocent people would do that. Also, psychopaths might be able to do that, right? Like, how many serial killers do we know about that were hidden in plain sight, completely able to do what they did and still be a part of society beyond suspicion? The probable cause affidavit seems to suggest that a single magic bullet, this is where they start to lose me by using colorful language like that. A single magic bullet is proof of Rick's guilt. It is a bit premature to engage in any detailed discussions regarding the veracity of this evidence until more discovery is received, but it is safe to say that the discipline of tool mark identification is anything but a science. The entire discipline has been under attack in courtrooms across the country as being unreliable and lacking any scientific validity. We anticipate a vigorous legal and factual challenge to any claims by the prosecution as to the reliability of its conclusions concerning the single magic bullet. I wish they wouldn't say magic. I wish they would just state the facts, but okay. I mean, I also understand that they might be in a position of like real frustration, right? That the case has gotten so much attention and that their client is guilty in the court of public opinion. That might be a reason why they would use such, you know, flowery language that they really didn't need to use. On Rick's behalf, we argue that the PCA, to have the PCA unsealed, Rick has nothing to hide. As importantly, we were hoping that we would receive tips that would assist us in proving up his innocence. Not surprisingly, we have been inundated with tips from a variety of sources, all of which will be vetted by our team. Although it is the burden of the prosecutor to prove Rick's guilt beyond a reasonable doubt, the defense team looks forward to conducting its own investigation regarding Rick's innocence. We appreciate those that have reached out to support this cause. The prosecutor mentioned, at least at the last hearing, his belief that others may have been involved in the killing, yet there was no mention in the PCA about a second suspect involved in the killing. And that actually brings me to a point that maybe I haven't covered yet. The affidavit of probable cause does not have to include all of the evidence they have. It just has to include the evidence that proves probable cause, that reaches that burden. So it's likely that they have other stuff that they say is evidence or they think is evidence against Richard M. Allen that is not included in that affidavit. So, the defense is confused by such discrepancies in the investigation and will be in a better position to respond as more discovery is received. They know that that is not a discrepancy. They know what affidavits of probable cause are, but they want to sow seeds of doubt, I think, in the public. And that's their job to do so. So kudos to them. Rick Allen owned a Ford Focus in February of 2017. His Ford Focus is not, in any way, similar to the distinctive look of the PT Cruiser or smart car that was described by the witnesses. It seems that the CCSD, the Sheriff's Department, is trying to bend the facts to fit their narrative. I'm curious if his Ford Focus is purple, though. They didn't bring up the color, which is interesting. Okay. At this point in time, we've received very limited information about the case and look forward to having something more to view than that which was offered up in the sparse PCA, that's probable cause affidavit. Moving forward, it is our intent to scrutinize the discovery as it is received and give the necessary attention to the volumes of tips that we are receiving. To the extent we continue to discover information that points to Rick's innocence, we will offer up this information to the public so long as we are not prohibited from doing so as a result of the recent request by the prosecutor for a gag order by the Indiana Rules of Professional Conduct. That motion right here. Oh no, this is a different motion. Let me go over to this is the case summary right here. It looks like this is the motion that was filed on November 22nd, which is a gag order. And I believe that that was or the issue, let's see. This was granted. Let's see. Oh no, that was the probable cause affidavit. That was this is it, the gag order right here. Court orders the state's motion for order prohibiting the parties, counsel, law enforcement officials, court personnel, coroner, blah, 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 from disseminating information or releasing any extrajudicial statement, blah, 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 blah. It's set for a hearing on January 13th. So, yeah, I mean, oh, hang on. The court. So they granted the order on December 2nd. So, yeah, so there is a gag order in place. So what we will see, if there's anything that we will see from the attorneys later on, remains to be seen. It looks like for now, at least that gag order is in place. So the last thing that I probably want to talk to you about is the motion for the change of venue. This is something that has come in. The defense does not believe that Richard M. Allen can get a fair trial within the Carroll County. So they have filed a motion for a change of venue. I don't think that I'll go into it specifically, but they do articulate all of the reasons that they believe that he can't get a fair trial in Carroll County. And you know what? I would be surprised if the prosecutor's office has fought that. I don't know. I haven't really digged into that facet of the case. But that is, I guess, what I wanted to show you when it came to the case in the murder of Abby and her friend Libby that we're all very, very familiar with. As it stands right now, Mr. Allen is still incarcerated. He was incarcerated on a huge bail. I think it was $20 million bail. So he is not going to see the outside of jail anytime soon, to my, I guess, my opinion. But who knows? We'll keep a close eye on this. And as actual information comes out about the case, I know I'm late to this party. I have not been covering the Delphi murders because it just hasn't been in my wheelhouse. The stuff that has been out, it just hasn't been in my wheelhouse. But now that we're starting to see some movement, I think as more stuff comes out, I will probably come back to this case and cover it in more detail as we get more detail. So with that, guys, let me just, as I finish out the video, for those of you who have stuck around to the end, let me just say thank you very much to my Patreon supporters. You guys, I just don't know what I would do without you when it comes to me getting documents on cases. I just don't know what I'd do without you. Thank you very much. If any of you who are not my patrons want to support me financially, check out Patreon, my Patreon page. Mostly, the biggest benefit that you get as being a patron of mine is access to all the documents that you help me pay to get, because most of these documents are not free. I've spent probably thousands of dollars this year just in getting documents on different cases. And so I really appreciate the $3, $5, $7 that people give me a month in order to be able to afford that. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And, with that, I mean, if you like this comment, please like, subscribe, hit the bell, all the things. If you think I deserve it, with that, I will bid you adieu and I hope to see you next time. Take care. Thank you very much for watching this video. If you liked what you saw, please subscribe to my channel. And if you have any comments or questions, please leave them below.